Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.
Thank you for joining us here at Pro-Life Berks. I'm Carolyn Bonkoski, co-host with Kathy Kuhns,
who's
our producer. Tonight we're going to be talking about love, so we have some love things to show you here. It is the month of February. It's the Valentine month. So we have lots of things to tell you about love, and we're going to have some songs for you, so we hope you enjoy this evening. Our guest this evening is Pastor David Reinhardt.
Reinwald.
Reinwald. Thank you.
That's okay.
It's a popular name.
Well, I'm thinking hearts.
Whatever.
Very popular. There's lots of us all over the world.
Thinking hearts. But at any rate, he is the pastor of the Kissinger's Church in Wyomissing, and he's going to share some of his personal songs that he's written.
Yeah, he's not just a pastor, he's a musician. He's quite talented.
I hope you enjoy it. So could you tell us a little bit about yourself, other than your name, which we now know?
Sure. I kind of like Reinhardt. I think for February it should be Reinhardt.
I like that.
Oh, that's why she made the slip. There you go. There you go. You're very versatile.
It'll be O'Reinwald or something.
We'll have you come back.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Anyway, it's great to be on here with Pro-Life Berks.
Oh, we're and so happy to have you.
You are champions for life, for children, and for moms, and for families. So it's a great privilege to be on with you folks.
And we're happy to have you. And like Carolyn said, our topic is love. And this world, there's that song, too bad we didn't ask you to sing that,
The World Needs Love.
Because we don't even have to tell our viewers. There's so many issues out there. Let's see what you...
Well, I'm originally from New Haven, Connecticut, so I'm a New Englander. It's kind of strange being from New Haven because we're kind of between Boston and New York, so I kind of have a halfway accent. You know, I say New York, and then I say park my car, which is Boston, so I get all confused that way.
You have to get a little Pennsylvania Dutch in there.
Yeah, I'm still figuring out. What's it called, a Fosna? Don't ask me how to spell that. I still don't know how to spell that.
But you can eat it.
Yeah, it's better to eat than to spell, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I lived in Connecticut most of my life, and it's interesting. I'm just going to jump into, in high school, I was a pro-choice kind of guy. I was unchurched, actually. My mom became very angry at God. My dad died in 1964. He had colon cancer.
Oh.
And so she was very angry at God, but she just didn't understand some things. And it's really fascinating how we didn't grow up in church. I have a twin brother, Billy, who's in Connecticut.
Hmm.
And I like to joke that Connecticut wasn't big enough for the both of us. So they sent the evil twin to Pennsylvania.
Oh, I'm sitting next to
that's
the
me.
Evil twin.
Okay, and he becomes a pastor. So think about it. I have poor odds of becoming a pastor, but God has amazing ways. He could do the impossible. Mm-hmm. So I grew up in a home that I learned Jesus' name in ways I don't want to repeat.
Oh.
So my mom was very angry at God. And then a dear lady named Caro, C-A-R-O, Caro Volt. I'll never forget this name for the rest of my life. My mom used to do house cleaning for her. And Caro said, Leona, my mom's name is Leona. Leona, why aren't the boys at church? And my mom would be like, well, you know. And then she mentioned my dad dying. She said, Leona, do you realize God has blessed you? Because your husband, Bill Sr., he should have died in the 1930s. He got colon cancer when he was like 16 or 17.
Really?
And the doctors gave him about 6 months to live. And he lived from basically 17, 18 years of age, I think it was, till 47 years of age.
Wow.
He should not have been alive to meet my mom,
number one.
Number two, Caro said to my mom, also, Leona, God knew that Bill was going to die, so he left you two boys.
Oh, boy.
He gave you two gifts,
wow.
Bill and Dave. We were born in 1960, and Dad died in 1964. And he was an accordionist. I still have his accordion.
No kidding.
I actually have pictures of him playing it from 1955.
Is your brother musical as well?
My brother is a wonderful musician. And if we do our John Denver show in May, which I'll mention later, Billy might come from Connecticut.
Bill, if you're watching, brother last time.
Well, if you're watching, Bill, if you're watching,
no pressure.
You need to come from Connecticut, okay? I'll take you out to Five Guys. I'll do something like that, okay? So anyway, my mother experienced God's love for the first time through this beautiful lady.
Wow.
And we started going to church. She had never been baptized. I actually witnessed my mother's baptism. And Billy and I actually sang at it. During that time, as we started going to church in our teen years, I met a girl named Gina. And lovely girl. She was the one that, you know, she did all the shows. She played Cinderella in Cinderella. Got all the lead parts. Very gifted dancer, actress, singer. We all wanted to date Gina, you know. And actually, I did get to date her, but that's a whole other story. we'll talk about that another time. So anyway, I was very pro-choice at the time because I was just kind of starting to go to church, and the church we were at didn't really talk about that sort of thing. So we dated for 2 weeks, okay? And during those 2 weeks, you could learn a lot about a person. And I found out that Gina also was a twin.
Oh my goodness.
Oh my goodness, and I'm a twin. Like, this is amazing, you know? And she knew my brother Bill. And she said something that changed my view of life and abortion for the rest of my life. I said, well, where's your twin? She goes, well, my mother was single and poor and that sort of thing, so she had an abortion. And my twin died during the abortion, and I survived.
Oh, my goodness.
That's chilling.
Wow.
I was 17 at the time.
Wow.
And I became pro-life at the age of 17, based on her story.
That's amazing.
And so Connecticut, I eventually, fast forward, became more spiritual, more into the Bible, studied Bible prophecy, the books of Daniel and Revelation. I'm actually doing a series at my church on the book of Revelation as we speak. I joked with someone recently. I said, well, I told my secretary, it's going to be about a two-month series, my administrative assistant, Beth, about a two-month series. So it's been in the bulletin 2 months. So I'm on part four right now. Or part five, I forget which one. I said, change it to several months. Because I'm having a hard time just getting out of chapter three.
That is so hard.
And there's a lot going on. There's a lot of study. Yeah. It's stretching me. So, but how do I become a pastor? I'm unchurched. I just started going to church as a teenager. Then I kind of fell away like a lot of us teenagers do. And then when I was like in my 20s, I went to a seminar in prophecy and I said, man, the Bible's pretty awesome. I'm understanding this book. And not that I know it all, but I'm starting to get it. I'm getting to know this person named Jesus, who's the center of the book, of not only the whole Bible, but the book of Revelation. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. And fast forward again, I became a truly committed Christian around the age of 24 or 25. Gave my life to Jesus. And I was a singer at the time. I did musical theater with Gina and others. And I also started writing love songs. So I read some love songs, hoping I'd make it to Broadway, maybe as an actor. I auditioned for some shows. Actually, I had a successful audition for an off-Broadway show. But I couldn't do the show because we didn't have enough money to keep the house going. Mm-hmm. So I ended up not doing that, which is probably a good thing. And so I became a Christian, really serious Christian at 24, started writing gospel music. And over about an eight-year period, I actually produced about five albums. Now, back then they were
albums.
Called...
Albums?
Yes.
Really?
Now, back then they were called cassettes. Remember that, folks?
Oh, yeah.
Cassettes. Huh. Okay? No eight tracks.
Right.
Just cassettes. I think I got to a CD by 1995 or so. I would write scripture songs. I'd take music.
Yeah.
I'd take scripture and write music to the scriptures. And just gospel music. I did a lot of touring in Connecticut, Rhode Island, Massachusetts.
We're lucky to have you here.
Oh, thank you.
Hurry up and tell your story because we want you to sing.
Oh, of course.
Well, there's plenty of time.
So anyway, I ended up in Pennsylvania. I got a call to the ministry. And I didn't go to college. Don't tell my church that, by the way. I'm not sure if they know yet. So I didn't go to college. And they know. And I just got this incredible call out of nowhere. I was 35 years old, working at a quality control department at a company in Worcester, Massachusetts. For all you folks from Massachusetts, that's Worcester, not Worcester, Worcester. So I get the call to Pennsylvania. I end up in Williamsport for about 7 years. And then I got a call to Reading. around 2001, right after 9/11.
Oh.
Literally a month after 9/11, I got a call to Reading. And I've been in the Reading area since 2002, and it's now 2019. It's been 17 years.
And how long at Kissinger's Church?
I've been at Kissinger's. It'll be 8 years May 1st.
Oh.
8 years May 1st. Time flies when you're having fun.
Yeah.
And it's amazing what God is doing there. We were actually, it was a Lutheran congregation,
uh-huh.
and I had come from the Adventist faith. I had worked in the Adventist Church, Seventh-day Adventist, mm-hmm. and I was off for about 5 years. I actually worked at Supportive Concepts for Families, which isn't too far from here, working with the intellectually disabled. And I received this call, and I'm not a Lutheran, they're Lutheran, but you know, God does the impossible. And so he brought us together. There was probably about 20 to 25 people attending at the time, most of them older than me. By the grace of God, over the last 8 years, we now go anywhere from 80 to 90 or so in attendance.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them are younger than me.
Oh.
But we welcome everybody. We don't card you at the door and say, we have to be under 60 to get to the, you know, we don't do that. we accept everybody from 6 to 106.
Yeah.
And we're non-denominational. We actually, the folks actually decided by the great, I don't want to offend anyone, but we just felt we should be non-denominational. We had such a combination of Catholic, Adventists who are coming, Greek Orthodox.
Oh my goodness.
I'll tell you what, I get some good stuff from, where's my friend Stella? If you're watching Stella. What's that? My wife's here in the audience. What's that stuff that Stella makes? And what's that? Baklava.
Oh, baklava.
I've had more baklava.
Oh, yeah, she's Greek.
Yep. I've had more baklava in the last 2 years than my entire life.
Wow.
And it's great.
Lucky you.
I love it. And so we have Methodist and Lutheran, of course. You name it. So we're just kind of a mixture.
Well, I know you get some Polish, so you have that kvasy.
Yeah,
oh, that's right.
Yeah.
That's right. The
get kvasy. A little mix in there.
There you go.
Well, how about singing for us? We can't wait.
Okay.
Now, the song you wrote for your wife, we'll save for later.
Okay, we'll
save
it a little
bit. That was so beautiful. But if you have just one of your favorites.
Yeah, well, we're doing a John Denver show on May 5th.
Oh,
Cinco de Mayo,
John Denver.
For another organization, a nonprofit, CASA, Court-Appointed Special Advocates for Children.
That's good.
Awesome organization.
Yes.
Do you know the Annie song then?
I'm sorry?
Is that the Annie song?
We're going to do a little John Denver for you. People think I sound like him.
You do.
Well, I was either going to do John Denver or Tiny Tim, and I...
No. John Denver.
No one
John
ever wants me to do Tiny Tim.
No.
I don't know why. I just don't understand that.
A lot of people don't know who he is, but you're not missing.
We do.
You're not missing anything.
You know, God rest his soul, but you don't want to hear Tiny Tim tonight. A little love song for you. You fill up my senses like a night in a forest, like the mountains in springtime, like a walk in the rain, like a storm in the desert, like a sleepy blue ocean. You fill up my senses, come fill me again. Come let me love you, let me give my life to you. Let me drown in your laughter, let me die in your arms. Let me lay down beside you, let me go always be with you. Come let me love you, come and love me again. You fill up my senses like a night in a forest, like the mountains in springtime, like a walk in the rain, like a storm in the desert, like a sleepy blue ocean. You fill up my senses, come fill me again.
Oh, that was beautiful.
You know, we do have Thank you. Telephone number where people can come in, they can ask him some questions, or they can make comments, whatever they would like to do. It's 610-378-0426. We do encourage that you do call in and talk to Pastor Bob. And also,
Reinhardt.
I don't know what's going on.
Bob Reinhardt.
But I also
should have just changed my name to Senator
Jones.
Why didn't I do that?
I probably would call you something else.
That's okay.
Oh my gosh.
People spell it wrong too, so it's okay, Carolyn.
Thank you.
That's okay.
All right. I also want people to know they can go onto the website and they can go to www.lovematters.com. That's LoveMatters.com. It's a wonderful, wonderful website about love and all the things that are involved, which Pastor Dave is going to expound upon.
Yes. Sure. That was beautiful. Really, I got chills. Yes. I mean, that was really good. Now, would you favor us with something you've written?
I'll be honored to. Like I mentioned, I've written lots of scripture songs and love songs. And I have a tradition with my wife, Jackie, who's here in the audience today. And the last 10 years, we've been married 10 years now, and my daughter Sarah, I think, is watching. Hi, Sarah. Daddy says hello. And give a kiss to the poochies. So we have two Yorkshire Terriers.
Oh. <That's cute.
laughs> And Sarah's 21, and I love these girls. I went through a tough time, honestly. I skipped this, but I'm going to say it because people think pastors, they tend to put us on a pedestal. And as you've seen in the news, we many times we have failed. We have failed the church. We have failed society. We're human beings like everybody else. And we should be praying for pastors and priests.
Absolutely.
Because the devil has a target on our back. And if he could bring us down, he could really mess up a church. Yep. And in 2006 and 2007, I went through a very tough time in my life. Went through a divorce. Whatever responsibility I need to take, I believe I've taken for that, and I resigned from the ministry. Might have been the toughest year of my entire life. Mm-hmm. God is gracious, and for those of you, I'm just going to lay this out. Anyone who's watching, who you've had an abortion, you've had a divorce, you know someone who's been divorced, had an abortion, feel like they failed. God is love. God loves us unconditionally. He doesn't love us based on our performance. He doesn't love us because we did everything right. He loves us whether we do everything wrong. And his love never changes. His mercies are new every morning. He's faithful to us every single day. And so I felt like I was a total loser. Here I was, a pastor, evangelist, singer, songwriter. I had planted two churches by the grace of God. There's a church on North 8th Street called Emmanuel's Place, a Seventh-day Adventist congregation that, by the grace of God, we started about 10, 11 years ago. And it's still there.
Yeah. Wonderful.
So I've been blessed. God brought me back into the ministry. But before he did that, he brought Jackie into my life. And he brought Sarah, her daughter, into my life. And these have been the best 10 years of my life. And it's because God is merciful and he's gracious. So whatever's going wrong in your life, I'm sorry, I'm becoming an evangelist tonight.
Yeah, that's okay.
But if you're watching and you know, I don't want to watch those pro-life people. We love you. If you've had an abortion, we love you. God loves you. And he will, I love what a preacher once said, God saves from the uttermost to the guttermost.
Oh, that's good.
And I was in the gutter, literally. I became unchurched. I became jobless. I was chickless, you might say. I was just totally lost in my, I don't know, how old was I then? In my 40s. Yeah, God restores. God is a God of restoration. Mm-hmm. And I met Jackie and Sarah. We've been married. We've been a family for a little over 10 years now. We just renewed our vows together. And I started this tradition. I didn't know it was going to happen this way. But our very first Christmas, I wanted to write her a song. So the joke is, I did this before we went on the air, the joke is I write her love songs because I'm too cheap to send her a card, give her a card. But then I realize I have to buy a frame for the song anyway, so I might as well just give her a card too. So I'm just kidding. She gets a card, both girls get a card, and so I wrote her a song for the first time. And I actually had friends of mine translate it into Spanish. Folks, I was their pastor at one time, uh-huh. because the church on North 8th Street is a Spanish church. How did that happen? It's a long story. But, you know, so...
God's been using you mightily.
God does it. So I wrote the song, sang it to her Christmas morning. Every Christmas since. It doesn't matter what I buy Jackie. It could be a Maserati. No, I don't buy Maseratis. Okay. Okay. It doesn't matter what it is, a toaster, that's not very cool, but anyway, whatever it is, yes. That moment, we sit in front of the tree with my girls, and Jackie looks at me, and I always have a little package, because I don't know how to rap. I can't rap, I can't song rap, gift rap, Christmas rap, I can't do anything like that, but she opens up, and I give her the frame with the lyrics.
Oh, that's
Merry Christmas.
So beautiful.
And she reads the lyrics, and then I grab my guitar, and I sing the song for the very first time.
You know, I think that if we have some women out watching this program, they must think you're like one in a gazillion.
Well, he is one in a gazillion.
Well, look.
No doubt about
it. How can we clone some of your...
Well, look, I have some problems, okay? Don't ask my wife. That's why I didn't let her on the air.
Yeah, but that is so that. Romantic and so loving. It's just...
Well, you know, we're all gifted in different ways. God has given me the ability to write music.
But you use your gifts. A lot of people don't.
Right. Yes.
They hide them under a lamp, as they say.
So, guys, you don't have to write songs to your wife. I can't fix anything. My wife fixes everything in the house. I'm useless.
She's smiling. We're watching.
I'm all thumbs, and I'm not even thumbs. I don't know what I'm all feet. And so my wife is actually the fixer-upper. One of her Christmas gifts, I'm going to say it on live television, was like a what was it, honey? I bought her a tool belt.
I thought you were going to say
electric
drill.
I bought her a tool belt. What's up with that?
You're like my
that's
daughter.
Crazy.
She does all the things.
So she fixes stuff. See, I didn't grow up with a dad, and I'm not. Yeah. That's a bit of a crutch. I'll tell you, you don't grow up with a dad. You lose a lot. Besides not knowing how to fix things. So guys, you could fix things around the house. You don't have to write songs. Just love your wife the way she needs to be loved. Whether it's fixing things, whether it's telling her you love her, giving her those meaningful hugs, some communication.
Communication.
At least some communication. Yeah. Anything.
That's a big one for me.
Yeah. Send her an email. Send her a text. Send her a meme. That's really pretty, you know. Send her something. And you know, I just have this thing in my spiritual life. I feel like God wants me to experience Him personally. And then after I experience God personally, my goal is to experience God in my family. That's like my circle. In other words, my circle with God is my first circle. I got to be right with God, or I'm useless to everybody. Yeah. So I got to be right with God every day. And then I got to be right with my family. That's my second circle. My third circle is my church family. And then the fourth circle is the community, reaching out to the community.
Oh, it finally gets to us.
Well, well, there you go. But you can't see, even as a pastor, we as pastors have made the mistake of working for the church,
right, and forget
instead of our family. Mm-hmm. Right. And there's many pastors' kids out there who are gone because they were sacrificed on the altar of the church. Mm-hmm. That shouldn't happen. My wife and my daughter come before anybody on this. Jesus first, my wife and daughter second, my church community third, and I'm a pastor.
And that could apply to any man, too.
Absolutely.
Work third, not first.
Exactly. It's got to go in that order.
Yeah.
But let's not skip the first part, which is God. Mm-hmm. Yeah. If we experience God first, let everything, it's like a pebble in a pond.
That's
just let that ripple effect flow out from your experience with God. And when we go in that order, when I go in that order, I'm doing okay. When I don't, and I think I lost that 12, 13 years ago when I went through my divorce and resignation. Yeah. I could have done it much, much better.
Yeah.
And I needed to repent, to learn. But I love what Pastor Tony Evans once said. Some of us, we make our mistakes, we make poor decisions, and then we keep looking at the past, and we keep staying in the past. And we never grow, we never go forward because we keep beating ourselves up. Some of us, we just like, that's all their fault. And that's not right either. But at the same time, some of us just flog ourselves, whether it's over an abortion, divorce, whatever.
And I wanted to mention, when you mentioned it before, if there is anyone watching who has had an abortion, there is Rachel's Vineyard. I don't know if you're familiar with that, where you can go for a weekend. And it's just a beautiful experience. You can bring, if you have a partner or a spouse, and they're suffering as well, and you can experience healing. And it's just a wonderful, wonderful experience. You can look it up online, or you can call any of the Catholic churches around here. They schedule Rachel's Vineyards weekends periodically throughout the year, and then you can find out which one's next and closest. So I highly recommend that for post-abortive women.
And sure. You do have that contact information on our website, too, don't
yes.
you?
Yes, yeah. And
it's which comes up at the end of the show.
Yeah.
So. And that's awesome, because we're not just pro-life, we're pro-mommy. And
exactly.
So if
we
the mommy needs help,
right.
we're not just saying, hey, don't do this. You know, we're saying,
right.
hey,
right.
go forward by the grace of God, and we're going to be there for you. And so getting back to the Christmas thing, every year since then, I've been writing a song for my wife. Right, honey? And so that's the big thing. And so this song, I wrote it, I think about 4 or 5. This is from 2014, Christmas morning 2014. My wife had surgery a couple weeks previous. And it was tough. Anytime your loved one goes under the knife, it doesn't matter what kind of surgery, it gets to you. And I was praying for her and praying to God. I love this woman, God, just protect her and use the gifts of the medical people. And so she did well. And the next morning I was getting ready to pick her up and I couldn't sleep. And I woke up and this line went through my head, where would I be? If something went wrong, where would I go? And I got up that morning, got the guitar out, and in 90 minutes I wrote the song. And normally it takes me longer, but it's called Where Would I Be? It's one of my love songs to my lovely wife, Jackie. And it goes like this. Where would I be if the surgery went wrong? What would I do if you died in my arms? Would I ever be right? Where would I be if we had to say goodbye? How could I live without you in my life? Where would I go? I'd run to God, he's the only one who can rescue me from my despair. He's the only one who can make me free if I ever lost you. I'd run to God, he's the only one who can heal the broken heart. He's always there. You can count on him when your life's falling apart. If I ever lost you, that's where I'd be. Where would I be? Time would only tell. Would I go on or choose a living hell? What would I do? Where would I be? This is what I pray. I'd put God first in each and every way. But what if I regress? I'd run to God, he's the only one who can rescue me from my despair. He's the only one who can make me free. If I ever lost you, I'd run to God, he's the only one who can heal the broken heart. He's always there. You can count on him when your life's falling apart.
if I ever lost you. Oh, I run to God, he's the only one who can rescue me from my despair. He's the only one who can make me free. If I ever lost you. Can heal the broken heart, he's always there. You can count on him when your life's falling apart. If I ever lost you, that's where I'd be. That's where I'd be. That's where I'd be.
Called Beautiful. God, a Woman, and a Man. It says, if there never was a singer, then there'd never be a song. If there never was a mother, where would the child belong? If a life was not worth living, I could not understand. But as a gift was made for giving, so was a woman made for man. God from the beginning had it in his plan.
Beautiful.
And he gave you a gift.
That's a wonderful
I'm grateful.
Gift.
I'm grateful. Yeah. I, as much as I wish I could fix a sink, I wouldn't trade music.
I'm sure your wife wouldn't either.
I really wouldn't. And if someone had to say, look, it has to be preaching, because I love preaching, I love pastoring my church, preaching or singing, it would be, it's like, what do you want to see or hear? What do you want? If you had to choose to lose something, vision or hearing, what would it? How do you make that decision?
Yeah.
And so I'm grateful to God. And I'm grateful for giving me the opportunity to come back and be as I thought I was done 10, 12 years ago.
It's because you appreciate it even more when that happens.
You know, and I tell folks, I feel like I'm a better pastor now.
I was just going to say, I think you're more sensitive to...
Yeah. I'm not trying to say I'm a great pastor. I just feel like I'm more sensitive. In fact, when folks come to my office and they want to get married, most of the folks that are getting married are, maybe on their second marriage or so. You know, it's a very touchy subject, you know. And within 5 minutes, I let them know, hey, by the way, I'm on my second as well.
Yeah.
And they just relax.
Yeah.
Oh, he's messed up like we are. And, you know, I don't have to... tell my folks, they know I'm a little messed up. But, one of the ways, I just feel like as pastors, I mentioned earlier on, don't put us on a pedestal. We are sinners in need of grace, just like everyone else. So no matter what you've done, where you've gone wrong, I have gone wrong in my life, and God has been merciful to me, a sinner.
Yeah.
And that's why we as, whether it's Pro-Life Berks or Kissinger's Church or whatever the organization is, as we know God, we can bring that love. And yes, I feel like I'm more forgiving and merciful because we love as we have been loved by Christ. You know, I love the story of, you know, Mary Magdalene and, you know, whether it's her, she loved as she was loved.
Yeah.
And by receiving God's love and mercy, we are able to bestow that love and mercy.
I want to read that beautiful Bible verse, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, which talks about, it's just the best, I think, verse in the Bible. Though I command languages both human and angelic, if I speak without love, I am no more than a gong booming or a cymbal clashing. And though I have the power of prophecy to penetrate all mysteries and knowledge, and though I have all the faith, if I am without love, I am nothing. Though I should give away to the poor all that I possess, and even give up my body to be burned, if I am without love, it will not matter. Love is always patient and kind. Love is never jealous. Love is not boastful or conceited. It is never rude and never seeks its own advantage. It does not take offense or store up grievances. Love does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but finds its joy in truth. It is always ready to make allowances, to trust, to hope, and to endure whatever comes. Love never comes to an end, but if there are prophecies, they will be done away with. If tongues, they will fall silent. And if knowledge, it will be done away with. For we know only imperfectly, and we prophesy imperfectly. But once perfection comes, all imperfect things will be done away with. When I was a child, I used to talk like a child and see things as a child does and think like a child. But now that I have become an adult, I have finished with all childish ways. Now we see only reflection in a mirror, mere riddles. But then we shall be seeing face to face. Now I can know only imperfectly, but then I shall know just as fully as I myself am known. And as it is, these remain, faith, hope, and love, the three of them, and the greatest of them is love.
Amen.
Thank you for that.
Amen.
I love that verse.
You've put some of the verses to music, have you not?
I have.
Do you have any favorites that...
You mean like scripture songs?
Mm-hmm.
Top of my head?
Well, I don't know. If you were going to do any of those for us this evening.
Oh, wow. You know, I've written about 100 songs. See, are we going to be here till 3 in the morning? Is that how it works? Well, the folks in the control room are like...
Why don't you share some of your... Well, he thinks. Why don't you share some of your... You brought some...
Someone gave me a little plaque here. Because I sing too. I'm a cantor in our church, and I've been in the choir forever and ever. So, and we do some fun things along the way as well. And it says, I am music. Now, I'm not going to read the whole thing because it's pretty long. But it kind of says nice. It says, I have taught men gentleness and peace. I have led them onward to heroic deeds. Because with the music, everything with music. Mm-hmm. I comfort the lonely. I harmonize the discord. I'm necessary luxury to all men. I am music.
Oh, that's really...
I love it.
Yeah, I was thinking about that today. I mean, this is what made me think of it. I was down at Planned Parenthood, and this young boy walking to the junior high was carrying a violin.
Oh, geez.
In his case. And I thought, oh, how great to see these young kids interested in music. And then that's what made me think of it. What would we have ever done without music? What a comfort and a joy.
And music's universal. It doesn't matter what language you speak. And I know anybody who doesn't like music? Is there anybody out there?
Yeah,
just call in and let us know why.
Right.
It's like not liking a buffet. I mean,
right.
Well, I love buffets too. I just thought of a song. Can I?
Oh,
it's a short little 1 minute thing.
Okay.
I used to write these little songs, and this is from John 13, 34 through 35. A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another.
Oh, that's perfect.
As I have loved you, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples. I used to write in King James. All my early songs from the 80s and 90s were King James songs, so I sing them in King James, though I preach from the New Living Translation now. But this is just a little song that goes along. I just thought of it. I haven't sung this song in probably 10 years.
Oh.
Is there dust on it? A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you, also love one another. A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you, also love one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have loved one for another. A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you, also love one another.
Did you write that?
Yes.
That's beautiful. Wonderful.
It's a neat way to memorize scripture.
Oh,
and
my
so
gosh, yeah.
I would just look at the Bible through my preparation for sermons or whatever, just my worship time. And I just run into these verses like that one. That's Jesus talking to his disciples, saying, look, I have a new commandment for you, that you love one another. You know, in the Bible, he actually talks about love others as you would like to be loved. Mm-hmm. But then he takes it a step further and he says, well, look, that's great, but I'm going to give you something even better. Don't just love people the way you want them to love you. Love people the way I love you. That's big.
That's big.
And don't get me wrong, the Bible doesn't say we have to like everybody.
Yeah.
I don't think everybody likes me. And if you don't call in, okay? But you don't have to like people, but God says we're commanded to love. I mean, we're commanded to love our enemies. We're supposed to pray for our enemies. And that's why even, you know, I love what you folks are about with Pro-Life Berks, because someone might call you an enemy. You know, you've been accused perhaps of many different things, okay? Whether it's on social media or in the newspaper. But, you know, we're really not the enemy. We're just lovers of people, lovers of babies, lovers of God. And
we're just trying to help.
Trying to help. And, you know, God doesn't force his way in. The Bible says in Revelation 3, Jesus stands at the door and knocks. That's one of my verses for this Sunday, Kissingers. Just want to let you know. Revelation 3, study up on that, okay?
They get homework.
Uh-oh. Yeah, you have homework now if you're watching. Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone will open the door, I will come in with him and sup with him and he with me. When the Bible talks about eating together, I love eating together. That's a whole nother sermon. That was something very, you know, that was accepting someone. When you ate with someone in the Bible, you were accepting them, you see? Mm-hmm. In the book of Acts, chapter 2, the early church, they would eat together. They would commune together and eat. Mm-hmm. So when Jesus says, I want to come in and eat with you, he's saying, I want to be close. I want you to be close to me. I want to be your God, your Savior. I call you not servants, but friends, he said to his disciples. Jesus is awesome. He really is. And anyway, I actually wrote a song to that verse as well.
It's amazing that you would say those things, because people who have gone through marriage encounter, that is to bring people who are in love or falling out of love but have been in love, back together. Mm-hmm. And one of the principles is that love is a choice.
Yes.
It's like you say, you know, you don't have to like people. You don't even have to associate with people. You do have to have love in your heart. Mm-hmm. So love is a decision. And then you mentioned about eating. And I have this book that I just happened to find. It says Breakfast with the Pope.
Oh, look at that.
That's perfect.
I know. I can't believe it.
Breakfast with the Pope, huh?
Yes, daily readings. Cute. Breakfast with the Pope. John Paul II. And he has one on music. Music and human harmony. Well,
I didn't know you folks were that close. I should have known you a lot sooner than now.
Music as an art is therefore an appeal to meditate on beauty. Beauty which springs from God, and an invitation to consider the harmony of creation. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of other things here, but it's harmony and all these things they fall together. They work together to enrich our lives.
It does. And love, you know, not to get into a lot of Greek with you. Mm-hmm. I do have a Greek lady, Stella, who comes to my church. And I always joke around with her. Stella, am I saying that right? Am I saying that word right? And she'll say, oh, yeah, there's how it is. Sometimes it's 2,000-year-old Greek. She's like, that's Greek to me. Get it? Don't turn off the TV. Don't turn off the TV. No more jokes. Okay. So, the word love. There's several Greek words for the word love. We have one word love in English, and I think we get confused. If I love my girlfriend, I love my boyfriend, well, you might, but how do you love them? And I think it's erotos, where's Stella to help me? Erotos has to do with erotic love. It's more of the, maybe a husband and wife, which isn't bad, you know, that sort of thing. You want that love just between the husband and wife, nobody else, where we get erotic love. Phileo. Philadelphia, city of brotherly love. Mm-hmm. That's phileo. That's the Greek word for that. I think charitas is another one where we get the word charity in the love chapter that you read for us, 1 Corinthians 13. It says faith, hope, and charity in some, like the King James Bible. I'm pronouncing it wrong because I didn't study before I came on tonight for that, but it's something like keratos or something. There's a lot, many smarter pastors than I that know the word in Greek. But the God, when John the Apostle says God is love, he doesn't use any of those words. Okay, he doesn't use phileo for brotherly love. He doesn't use, for charity. He doesn't use the word for erotic love, eros. He uses a Greek word called agape.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
A-G-A-P-E. God is agape. And that Greek word blew the minds of everyone. Because all the gods that they worship, you know, the false gods, the pagan gods, the heathen gods, they were trying to appease these gods to accept them, you see. But this God that John wrote about loved people unconditionally. In other words, agape doesn't love you because you're beautiful or you're handsome or you're talented or you've been a good boy or a good girl. Agape doesn't mean that. Agape chooses to love. God so loved the world, John 3:16, right? Mm-hmm.
John 3:16.
The Greek there is agape. So in other words, what the Greek is saying is God so loved the world unconditionally, no strings attached. Not because you're nice or you smell good or you look good or you're, the Bible says in Romans 5, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Mm-hmm. God commendeth his love for us by giving his son to us. So this love of God it's proactive, it's not reactive. In other words, we don't go, well, we better go love God, because if we don't, we're going to be lost and we're going to be judged. No. God so loved first. You see, God's love, his agape love, is proactive. There's someone who penned the words, it almost sounds sacrilegious, but he talked about the hound of heaven. You ever heard that term, the hound of heaven?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And what the writer was trying to say was, we're not searching after God. In reality, God is searching after us.
True.
The Bible says in Luke 15, I believe, that, or like Luke 19 or Luke 15, where it says, the good shepherd leaves behind the 99 mm-hmm. and goes searching for right. the one lost sheep. Mm-hmm. Many people have a picture of God, well, he loves the 99, I'm the one lost sheep. Why is God interested in me? I don't care, I've cursed his name many times, I've thrown my life away many times. People think that, and that's what the devil wants people to think. Mm-hmm. I've had too many of this, too many of that, I've screwed up. No. The Bible says the good shepherd, Jesus, leaves the 99 mm-hmm. to go find the one lost sheep. And he does not stop searching until he finds the sheep. That's what it actually says in the verse. He doesn't stop searching. So friend, if you feel like you're just a mess, I mean, I keep coming back to this because I've been there. I'm sorry, I just hit my microphone. Did that come out? I swore I wasn't going to do that. I just did it. Okay. Don't miss this. No matter what's going wrong, whether it's an abortion, a divorce, alcoholism, drug abuse, sexual issues, pornography, whatever your issue, God is still searching for you because he is love. He is agape, and he is wanting you to be right with him, and he wants you to be in heaven. He wants you to be in heaven. That's why he mm-hmm. sent his son Jesus to die for yeah. your sins. And Jesus, when he died on the cross, he died for every single sin.
Yeah.
There's no sin that Jesus didn't die for. Oh, I've done this too much, or I've been too bad at this. This is the worst sin. Jesus died for the very worst sins. Yeah. And that's agape. That mm-hmm. is love. You want love? This is love. Yeah, heart is love. Yeah, Cupid is love. Right. I'll tell you what. The cross, that's love. The cross, that is love.
That's beautiful. Why do you think that there isn't more love in the world? I mean, it seems like things are getting worse mm-hmm. in many ways.
Yeah.
There's so much hostility and at every level,
before you answer that, I just wanted to pick up on what you were saying. There's a song called Isaiah 49 from the Bible by Reverend Carrie Landry.
Okay.
And one of the verses, it says, does a mother forget her baby?
Oh, yes.
Or a woman the child within her womb? Mm-hmm. Yet even if these forget, yes, even if these forget, I will never forget you.
Amen.
And that's what you're talking about.
Yes.
That's agape love.
Yes.
I mean, some of our friends might get mad at us, and then they're not our friends anymore. And that happens even within families.
Mm-hmm.
God doesn't do that to us.
Amen.
He doesn't.
No. If anyone's lost, it's not because God rejected you. It's because you rejected
God.
Because
you walked away.
That's the truth.
Yeah.
If we don't reject God, I love a statement that was written many years ago. If we will not resist the drawing magnetic love of God, he will draw us all the way to the foot of the cross.
People are searching, but they don't always know what they're...
And they are, and they are.
They
I said earlier, it's not people mm-hmm. searching after God, it's God searching after people. God is searching after people. Mm-hmm. That's agape love. Mm-hmm. But yes, people are searching.
He puts that emptiness in there.
Well, think about it. If you're searching after God, guess who put that search engine in you?
Right.
Did I just say search engine?
Yes.
We got it.
That's Yahoo thing or Google thing. But God placed that desire in your heart. He already did that. Mm-hmm. So you ask the question, what's going on with the world, right? Mm-hmm. To put it bluntly, the world has been rejecting God mm-hmm. and his love. Because the opposite of agape is self-love. It's self-serving. Agape is
narcissism.
Yeah, narcissism. Agape love is emptying. It's an emptying love. You know, God put us first. I mean, think about it. We sinned against him. And yet, he's the one who made things right. You know, if two people argue or they debate over something, you know, I'm not going to apologize, it's his fault. Well, guess what? It was our fault. Garden of Eden, hello? And yet, God came down anyway. Said, I know you guys messed up, but I'm going to make it right with you, even though most of you will probably not want to make it right with me. Without that agape love, without inviting God into our hearts, without opening the doors of our hearts, as I recited mm-hmm. in Revelation 3, we need that love to be selfless. But I see the world becoming more selfish than selfless.
You see more and more articles about that.
Exactly. So, quick acronym, JOY. You really want to experience God's love, put Jesus first, others second, and yourself third. Jesus, others, yourself. Worship God with all your heart, all your mind. Love God with all your heart, all your soul. You know how it goes.
Yeah,
and love your neighbor as yourself. Experience Jesus. Love him foremost. Invite him into your heart. Experience him. He will give you the love. We don't have that love in and of ourselves. We're naturally selfish.
Yeah,
We're naturally selfish. But when we allow God into our lives, he gives us this agape love for others. And so we put Jesus first. And then we'll love others second, and we'll be third. And guess what? It's a great life.
Yeah.
It's a great life. Living for God instead of ourselves is a great life. Try it sometime.
Do you have time for? We have about 8 minutes left. Can you give us one more song?
Oh, is that what the sign says? Is that?
How many? Was that 4 minutes?
You want to make your announcements,
and then we can
make some announcements, and maybe we can fade out with a song.
February 23rd. If you'd put the notice up that I brought. February 23rd is called, it's going to be a national day of mourning because of all the legislation, particularly in New York State, where they would now make it legal to kill a baby up to the moment of birth. So this is a day of mourning. Wear black. Don't shop. If you have a business, close your business and repent for abortion and pray. So we just ask that you consider doing that.
And what is the date again?
February 23rd.
Okay. What day of the week? Do you know what day?
I don't know what day.
Right.
Okay. So we're going to end with Pastor Dave. He's going to give us a song. And if we don't have any more time, thanks for tuning in.
All right. We're going to take two songs, Amazing Grace and a song by the Eagles. We're going to do some 70s here, and we're going to mash them together. And if you're home and you're watching on your TV or computer, just sing along, right? Okay, so.
Amazing grace, how sweet is the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now got a peaceful, easy feeling. I know he won't let me down, 'cause I'm already standing on solid ground.
Isn't that cool?
Love it.
Oh, wish I put that together, but I didn't.
'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed.
Are you ready, folks?
And I've got a me down, 'cause I'm already standing on solid ground. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun,
everyone. Thank you.
Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.